thanks for the introduction and of course the opportunity to be here today presenting to you. So this afternoon I'm going to speak about exercise for neck pain. And I'd just like to start by very briefly introducing or reviewing the enormous burden of neck pain. So neck pain, of course, is one of the most common musculoskeletal conditions. It has an annual prevalence of around 50% and a lifetime prevalence of around 70%. In the main, it's not a catastrophic condition, but of course it can certainly have a significant impact on a person's work, on their recreation, and obviously their quality of life. Neck pain spares no age, no gender, and no culture. The other important feature of neck pain is that following a first episode, it is very common to have repeated episodes, so there's a very high chance of recurrence. And that, of course, can extend across a lifetime. And actually up to 85% of people can expect to have some degree of ongoing neck pain following their first episode, with around 30% of patients developing chronic pain. Now, when it comes to treatment or management of neck pain, then there's certainly evidence from systematic reviews and meta-analyses to confirm the effectiveness of exercise, not just for the relief of pain, but also for the prevention of pain. And so, of course, effective and early management of exercise, of pain via exercise is obviously promoted as a critical element of rehabilitation and is hence in our clinical practice guidelines internationally. Now, when it comes to the analgesic effects of exercise, then various different forms of exercise have been proposed to relieve neck pain. And that includes strength and endurance type training programs, programs based on flexibility and improving range of motion, graded activity or programs focused more on cognitive behavioral techniques, very specific motor control and motor learning programs, and of course, aerobic exercise for general fitness. And actually, what our systematic reviews tell us is that there is currently very little evidence of superiority of one exercise program over another for relieving neck pain. So just to give you an example, if we compare 6 weeks of craniocervical flexion training, which is of course designed to very specifically address activation or facilitate activation within the deep neck flexors, the longus coli, longus capitis, and therefore follows a motor control or motor relearning approach, and we compare that to a general strengthening program for the neck flexors, both programs applied over a six-week period in patients with chronic idiopathic neck pain, relatively mild to moderate disability, then it didn't really matter how many studies that we did, we actually consistently reached the same conclusion, and that is there was a comparable reduction in the patient's perceived pain and disability between groups at the end of the intervention. And that's just illustrated in this example here, showing you the results of two of those studies, each presenting the reduction, or sorry, the change in patients' perceived pain and disability based on their NDI score. And you can see the craniocervical flexion training group in blue, the strength training group in orange. Both groups did have a significant reduction in their perceived disability, but there's no difference between the two interventions. Here's another example. This is a clinical trial comparing three different exercise interventions for patients with mechanical neck pain, once again, relatively mild to moderate disability. We have in blue the craniocervical flexion training program. So once again, very low load program based on motor control and motor relearning. Another third of the patients randomized into still craniocervical flexion training, but this time more of an endurance type program. So using a dynamometer and performing more moderate intensity and longer duration contractions. And then the other third of the patients randomized to enter in a program designed to enhance range of motion and flexibility. And you can see from this slide that each of the three programs, in terms of pain and disability reduction, once again on the neck disability index, then at 10 weeks, all three groups are showing a significant reduction in their pain and disability. That was retained at the 26-week follow-up, but there's no difference between the three interventions. And the final example, this time a study comparing progressive resistance exercise for the neck muscles based on elastic bands versus general physical activity, which involved general fitness as well as resistance exercise for the lower limb and the upper limb, but not specifically the neck. And it's the same story. So in terms of neck pain and disability reduction, both groups at the end of the 12-week program are showing comparable changes in perceived pain and disability. So as said, systematic reviews are of course reaching this conclusion that there's little evidence of superiority of one exercise program over another for reducing perceived pain and disability. And this has led to the conclusion in many papers that actually, therefore, the decision for the type of exercise to use in people with neck pain should be dictated by the clinician's preference. And I would like to respectfully disagree with that conclusion and actually provide evidence which supports the need for specificity when prescribing exercise for people with neck pain. And I'm going to do that by going through the following three points. The first point is that the same exercise does not necessarily achieve the same effect in different neck pain disorders. The second point is that perceived pain and disability is important, but perhaps it's not the only relevant outcome measure that we should be considering. And then finally, and perhaps most importantly, I'd like to focus on the fact that there's very clear evidence that specificity of exercise is critical to modify neuromuscular function. Okay, so let's start with the first point, which was the same exercise does not necessarily achieve the same effect in different neck pain disorders. And to address that point, I'd like to consider craniocervical flexion exercise. So craniocervical flexion exercise, which is designed to facilitate activation and endurance within the deep neck flexors, so longus coli, longus capitis, was originally developed and designed for patients with cervicogenic headache. And one of the key physical findings for cervicogenic headache is, in fact, impairment when we test those muscles through craniocervical flexion testing. And so it would make sense that the exercise which is designed to target that particular feature should have efficacy, should be efficacious for the treatment or management of those patients. And indeed it is, okay? So this is the results from one of the original clinical trials evaluating craniocervical flexion training for cervicogenic headache. It was a 6-week intervention, and what you can see here, firstly, is the percentage of patients that had at least a 50% reduction in their headache frequency after the 6-week period, and then the percentage of people that had 100% complete relief of their headache after the 6-week period. So it was around 31% of the cohort. And bear in mind that these patients on average had had their headache for 6 years. And then at a 12-month follow-up, around 40% of the patients were 100% free of their headache. So they are good results, but again, that's an exercise that was specifically designed to target a physical deficit in those patients. Now, if we look at the results of that exercise applied in a different neck pain disorder, this time people with idiopathic neck pain, relatively mild symptoms, after a 6-week intervention, the average change in their pain intensity was rated around 47%. Okay, so still quite good. It was a significant finding compared to a control intervention. But then if we have a look at the same approach to exercise being applied in people with still idiopathic neck pain, but now more moderate to severe symptoms, we can see it's gone down to 25% benefit after 6 weeks of training. And once again, that was still effective relative to treatment as usual, but it's not as impressive as the previous results. And then as a final example, if we then look at the effect of neck-specific exercise in a group of patients with whiplash-associated disorders, also presenting with cold hyperalgesia, which is considered to be a sign of central sensitization, then the benefit's gone down to 16%. So less and less impressive results as we move into more complex patient presentations. And so we have to obviously be aware and consider that clearly if there are, for example, in this case, pain that is centrally driven or centrally mediated, we can't possibly expect the same effect when we're trying to induce a very specific local change in muscle control. Now, that's not to say that neck-specific exercise is not relevant for whiplash. It's just that there are various factors that can interfere with response to neck-specific exercise. And we've explored this in a number of studies, And some of the key factors that come out are their average pain intensity, but also some of the psychological factors like the degree of pain catastrophizing, their post-traumatic stress reaction, and also pain extent. So in other words, how widespread the pain is. And of course, widespread pain is also typically associated with central sensitization. So in a more recent study, we've actually demonstrated that the size of the painful area is an important determinant in outcome in terms of change in NDI, perceived pain and disability, both 1 year as well as 2 years following a neck-specific exercise. But as I said, it's not to say that neck-specific exercise is not relevant for that group, because actually, in other studies, we've been able to demonstrate that participation in a neck-specific exercise versus general physical activity for patients with chronic whiplash-associated disorders was superior. Okay, so actually, at a 12-month follow-up, after a 3-month intervention, patients that were randomized and participated in the neck-specific exercise intervention were 5.3 times higher odds of disability reduction 1 year later, and around 4 times odds of pain relief 1 year later after the intervention. So there's still certainly evidence to support neck-specific training in that particular neck pain disorder. My second point is that perceived pain and disability, although of course it's very relevant, it may not necessarily be the only factor that we should be considering. So for instance, if we look at clinical trials for exercise for neck pain, then reduction in pain and disability is typically the primary outcome. And given that pain is multifactorial, it would seem that a single method of measuring pain as the sole outcome to decide whether one exercise is better than another is just, it's insufficient. So to demonstrate that, let's come back to this example where we considered craniocervical flexion training versus the strength training. 6-week intervention for people with chronic idiopathic neck pain with relatively mild to moderate disability. And we've already concluded that when we looked at the results of many different exercise trials comparing those two exercises, the same conclusion was reached in that both groups were inducing a comparable amount of reduction in the patient's perceived pain and disability rated on the neck disability index, and which, by the way, is the most common questionnaire that's used as a primary outcome in exercise trials. But let's consider for a moment another feature of pain. Let's look at the results by measuring pressure pain thresholds taken over the most symptomatic segment in the neck. And let's look at immediate changes in hypoalgesia. So this is a study comparing exactly the same two exercises, so craniocervical flexion versus cervical flexion. But pre to post intervention here is no longer 6 weeks in duration, it's literally 3 minutes of performing the exercise. And what was shown in this study is that craniocervical flexion training actually had a superior immediate hypoalgesic effect. So in other words, the pressure pain threshold over the most symptomatic site increased, which means that there was a reduction in mechanical sensitivity. So that was found, and the other finding from that study was that the craniocervical flexion training, but not the cervical flexion, actually also induced a significant reduction in pain during active movement. And once again, that was an immediate finding. And this can be very relevant, of course, in terms of managing people with perhaps more severe pain or even people with acute pain. Okay, so we need to think about other factors, not just outcome following 6 weeks in terms of perceived disability reduction and pain reduction. In addition, qualitative research has shown that patients articulated that the immediate demonstration that exercise could help them in terms of reducing their pain gave them hope and motivation to do their exercises. So once again, we may decide to use one exercise over the other, particularly early on in the piece, to encourage adherence to exercise programs. And this is a second example. This is a clinical trial in chronic whiplash-associated disorders comparing neck-specific exercises versus physical activity. And the next specific exercise, actually, there were two groups, one with a behavioral approach and one without a behavioral approach. And as I said, these were both compared to general physical activity across the course of a 3-month period. And then there was a 12-month follow-up as well. What you're looking at here is the change in their neck pain disability, both at 3 months at the long-term follow-up. And the main conclusion from the original trial was that neck-specific exercise was beneficial, both with and without a behavioral approach, compared to physical activity, but there was no difference between the two neck-specific exercise groups. Now, the main difference between those two groups is that with the neck-specific exercise with the behavioral approach, those patients were encouraged to exercise through their pain, so to sort of carry on, not be worried about their pain, and to keep exercising through it. And the opposite was told to the patients just within the neck-specific exercise. So they were told to be very mindful of their symptoms, to modify their exercises when they felt their pain was being provoked, and to adjust the load and so forth. But as said, in terms of perceived pain and disability, there was no difference between those two groups. But let's now think of another parameter related to pain. So one potentially important feature in whiplash can be the size of the painful area, given that many people actually feel not just a very localized neck pain, but often widespread pain. And of course, by having the patients complete their pain drawings at baseline and then progressively after an intervention and even at follow-up, we can calculate the size of their painful area, both frontal and dorsal, and effectively monitor that shrinking of the painful area over time. And when we took the original data from that randomized controlled trial comparing neck-specific exercise with and without a behavioral approach, and we now looked at pain extent or the size of the painful area as the primary outcome measure, actually this is when we could start to see differences between our two interventions. So in other words, on the left-hand side here, you can see our neck-specific exercise without the behavioral approach, and there was a significant reduction or shrinking of the painful area, not just after the intervention, but it was retained 12 months later. Whereas for our next specific exercise with the behavioral approach, there was no change in the painful area, despite the fact that they had a comparable reduction in their perceived pain and disability. In another study, once again on the same original data set, but this time focusing on the psychological aspects, actually the next specific exercise also showed superior effects in terms of reducing kinesiophobia, anxiety, and also improving self-efficacy. So although, as I say, pain and disability is relevant, we may need to start thinking about other features, particularly if we do have patients that have very widespread pain or that have very high levels of kinesiophobia or anxiety, just to give an example. And then my third point, and perhaps my most relevant point that I'd like to make, is that specificity of exercise is actually quite critical if our aim is to restore neuromuscular function. So pain, of course, is important, okay? And it's usually the primary reason that the patient would come and seek treatment. But the challenge, of course, as clinicians, is not just to resolve an episode of pain. The challenge is actually try to prevent or limit recurrence of pain for the patient's future quality of life. And therefore, when we're prescribing exercise, we should be thinking not just about pain relief, but actually about prescribing exercise with the aim of restoring neuromuscular function. It is extremely well documented in the literature that people with neck pain can present with an array of neuromuscular disturbances. And they can range from simply a reduction in neck strength, to restricted range of motion, to decreased speed of movement, delayed responses, to some more specific changes, including increased coactivation of the neck muscles, proprioception impairments, and so forth. There's also very clear evidence to indicate that even if we manage to relieve the pain, for example, with passive interventions, manual therapy, for instance, that those neuromuscular deficits actually remain. And of course, that makes us think that they have the potential to then contribute to the next episode of pain and the next episode of pain. And so, as I said, exercise to restore neuromuscular function would just seem a logical component of any management program for a person with neck pain. And I just would like to give an example. So this is an example of a specific neuromuscular deficit that's been found in people with chronic neck pain, and then we're going to see if exercise can restore that. So this is a study where we've taken people, both chronic neck pain and asymptomatic people, and we've effectively locked their head into a brace, into a dynamometer, but asked them to produce a specific amount of force and to maintain that force in 360 degrees. So that essentially they're doing a circular contraction with their head, albeit it's isometric. And as they do that, we record electromyography from various different neck muscles. And this is an example of a recording from the left sternocleidomastoid of a healthy control or an asymptomatic person. And essentially, this is an EMG tuning curve. And an EMG tuning curve is simply an indication of which directions of force is the muscle active. So in this case, we can see that the muscle is active when the person's pushing into flexion, becomes even more active in ipsilateral antrolateral flexion, still a bit active in lateral flexion, but then in the extension phase of the task, the muscle's quite relaxed, as we would expect, because that's when the muscle's acting as an antagonist. And the point to see is that normally our neck muscles are activated in very specific directions. They have a clear preference for direction, and of course that's simply based on the anatomical considerations. Now, to quantify that, because we want to compare that to chronic neck pain, we can simply extract a vector where the direction of that arrow is pointing to the muscle's preferred direction of activation. Okay, so in the case of the sternocleidomastoid up the top here, its preferred direction normally is ipsilateral antrolateral flexion. And for the splenius capitis bilaterally down the bottom, we see it's ipsilateral posterolateral extension. Remembering also that it's very normal not to have a large overlap in terms of coactivation. So not only do we look at the direction of that arrow, but by measuring the length of that arrow, we can define the degree of muscle specificity. So the longer the arrow, the more tuned the tuning curve, and therefore the more specific the muscle activation. So keeping that in mind, if we now look at an example from a person with chronic neck pain, you will see that we often can see a loss of that specificity of muscle activity. So if we take the example at the top of the left sternocleidomastoid, yes, it's still active in flexion and anterolateral flexion and even in lateral flexion, but you'll see that it's almost equally active during the extension phase of the task when it should actually be quite relaxed. And likewise for the splenius capitis. So yes, it's active during extension, but almost equally active in flexion. So we're seeing in this representative example from somebody with chronic neck pain that there's clearly a lot of coactivation of the neck flexors and extensors. And if we look at the measure of specificity, I've presented the example just down here for the right splenius capitis, because at least in this example, the arrow is pointing in the direction that we would expect. Okay, but you may note that that line is shorter, and that's because the tuning curve is less tuned. And so if we now compare overall for our study chronic neck pain versus healthy controls, you will see for the sternocleidomastoid up the top and the splenius capitis down the bottom, overall there was less directional specificity in neck muscle activity in people with chronic neck pain. And this implies a direct and specific change of the neural drive to the neck muscles. Can we change it with exercise? And more importantly, does it matter what type of exercise that we do? And to address that question, we conducted an exercise trial, a clinical trial, in patients with chronic idiopathic neck pain, moderate disability, and randomized the patients into two groups. Half of the patients participated in a program of neck-specific exercise over the course of 8 weeks, and this was a program that addressed both flexor muscles and extensors, and went from a very specific low-load motor control approach right through to high-load strength and endurance training across the 8 week duration. The control group was still treatment. It was treatment as usual, which included general physical activity. We saw the patients at baseline. We saw them immediately after the 8 week intervention, and our interest here was that measure of directional specificity of muscle activity to see whether we could change that with training. So this slide firstly presents a representative example from a person assigned to the treatment as usual group up the top and another person assigned to the next specific exercise down the bottom. And these are the EMG tuning curves at baseline. Blue is the sternocleidomastoid bilaterally, orange is the splenius capitis bilaterally. And the point to see at baseline is that they're not very specific. We're actually seeing similar to what we saw in that last study, is there's a lot of co-activation and it appears that they've lost that specificity. This is the same person from the treatment as usual group after the 8-week intervention. And if we look at those tuning curves, they're not looking that different to baseline, certainly no obvious improvement. They're looking as equally unfocused as they were at the beginning. Whereas if we now look at this example from the person, a person assigned to the next specific exercise group, we're actually now starting to see much more specificity in the way the neck flexors and extensors are working. And in fact, we're starting to see tuning curves which are more comparable to what we would see in asymptomatic people. And that's just representative data, but if I show you the group results for the study, treatment as usual on the left there, pre to post, no significant change in that measure of muscle specificity, whereas there was a significant increase in our next specific exercise program. And so that highlights the importance of being specific in order to specifically address neuromuscular impairments. And perhaps not surprisingly, the patients in the next specific exercise group also reported a significantly greater improvement in their perceived function after the end of the intervention. That being said, what we're comparing here is next specific exercises versus general activity. We still don't know from that data whether any kind of neck specific exercise would be equally effective. So could we just do strength training? Could we just do a motor control program? Because they're certainly similar in terms of pain or effects on pain. And so if we come back again to these studies here where we've compared exactly that. So remember, craniocervical flexion training, very low load in nature, tries to be very specific to facilitate the deep neck flexors, minimize activation of the sternocleidomastoid, whereas the global neck flexion training is involving repeated head lifts from supine, and of course, if you lift your head off the bed, you'll activate all of the neck flexors, both deep and superficial. So it's higher load, and it's a little less specific, albeit it's still a neck exercise. So we've already seen that pain is comparable between the two groups, but what about some of the neuromuscular deficits commonly seen in people with neck pain? Well, one of them that we tried to address was coordination between the deep and superficial muscles, specifically on the craniocervical flexion test. So we'd learned many years ago by directly measuring the deep neck flexors with a very specific nasopharyngeal electrode that if we compare activation of the deep neck flexors across progressive interrange positions of craniocervical flexion, that on average people with neck pain had lower activity. This was associated with higher activity of the sternocleidomastoid. So what we'd like to understand now is, can training reverse that? Okay, and does it matter which one we do? So these are the results firstly for the deep neck flexors. So we've got craniocervical flexion training on the left, strength training on the right. That's pre-training. This is the result post-training. And we could actually see a clear difference between the two groups. So it was only our craniocervical flexion training that showed a significant increase in activation in those muscles, even if strengthening training through neck flexion would actually activate those deeper muscles as well. Likewise, we found that the only group that had a significant reduction in sternocleidomastoid activity was the craniocervical flexion group, whereas there was no consistent and significant change for the strengthening group. And so this is already starting to support the need for specificity, even within a neck-specific protocol. To give another quick example, this is a study where we monitored postural endurance across a computer task, so taking chronic neck pain patients in healthy controls and putting them in an upright position, and then simply distracting them by having them play a game on the computer. But every 2 minutes, taking a photograph of them so that we can measure the cervical angle. And once again, we'd learned from earlier work that when we we ask them to perform this computer game for 10 minutes, and if we look at the cervical angle in healthy controls on the right there, you can see the angle staying nice and steady over time. So that red line is the average for the group. You can see the angle's no different. For the neck pain patients, they could achieve the upright position. There's nothing wrong with their posture. The problem that they had is they couldn't sustain it. Okay, so very quickly that angle was changing progressively over time, so they were drifting into a forward head posture. So then we did another study comparing our same two exercise groups to see whether either had an effect on postural endurance. And to cut a long story short, we found that it was only the craniocervical flexion training program that was able to demonstrate a significant improvement in the people's ability to maintain that upright position whilst distracted playing the computer game. There was no significant change for the strength training group. And bear in mind that these patients were only practicing supine, so we didn't get them up into functional postures as we normally would clinically. But even still, there was a transfer of effect, and that's because, of course, that some of the key muscles to maintain an upright position of the cervical lordosis is in fact the longus coli, which the exercise is addressing. But then very finally, to give one last example, if we think about higher load function now, so a measure of neck flexion strength. We all know neck flexion strength, or neck strength in general, is typically affected in people with chronic pain. Now, and perhaps not surprisingly, the only group that's benefited is the strengthening group. Okay, so despite the fact that the craniocervical flexion group had a comparable change in pain, they've had positive effects in other aspects of neuromuscular function, it had no transfer to that higher load function. Of course, the same was vice versa. And that illustrates, firstly, the importance of progression with training, but also the need for specificity. And although they're just three quick examples, there's been a number of studies, both from our group, but of course many others, which have clearly demonstrated that exercises need to be selected to target deficits in neuromuscular function if that's going to be one of our aims. In addition, what's also been shown is that by being specific and targeting specific aspects of neuromuscular function, which may be problematic for a particular patient, then you're actually more likely to get a better effect in terms of pain relief. And to illustrate that point, I just want to show you one study, which once again was craniocervical flexion training. And it was a 6-week training intervention, and that's the only exercise that the patients did for that 6-week period. So they were told to practice their exercise every single day, twice a day for that 6-week period. And what you're looking at here is the relation between measures of the activity within the deep neck flexors before training, so at baseline, and then the percent increase in activation of the deep muscles after the 6-week intervention. And you can see a clear relationship there, which implies that the patients that had the least activation of the deep neck flexors before training were the patients that had the greatest improvement in activation of those muscles. And in a way, that seems quite intuitive because they had more room for improvement. But importantly, it relates to pain relief. Okay, so in the second slide, what you're looking at is the relationship between the change in pain over the 6-week period and the change in activation within the deep neck flexor muscles. And what we can see here is that the people that had the greatest change in activation of their deep muscles also had the greatest pain relief. What it also shows, however, is that there were several people in the study that had absolutely no benefit whatsoever, despite the fact that they've done an exercise every single day, twice a day, for 6 weeks. Reason being is that they didn't have the deficit that we were trying to address with that particular exercise. So ultimately, studies are highlighting the need for assessment-driven, targeted interventions for better effect in terms of pain relief. Yet despite that, if we look at clinical exercise trials, it is very rare to see, as an inclusion criteria, the specific aspect of neuromuscular function that we're trying to actually address. So for instance, it's very rare to see in a strengthening program for the neck that an inclusion criteria is people with neck pain that have a strength deficit. Okay, so I think we need to really think about being more specific and considering trials, because we're probably getting a big washout of effects by having people included that the exercise is simply not relevant for. So very simply, rather than saying is exercise A better than exercise B, We need to consider what are the causal mechanisms of recovery for an individual patient. Has the mechanism changed to warrant a change in the patient's outcome? Or in other words, which exercise is actually better at altering specific mechanisms? And as a final point to illustrate that, I want you to consider this clinical trial again, which was the clinical trial in chronic whiplash comparing neck-specific exercise to general physical activity for 3 months. And essentially what was shown in that study, remember, is that neck-specific exercise, which was a program for flexors and extensors, lower load right through to higher load training over 3 months, was superior to general physical activity, not just immediately after the intervention, but also at the 12-month follow-up. And that was in terms of their neck pain reduction, of course. But what that doesn't tell us is why. Okay, why was the neck-specific exercise more effective than just being physically active? And to address that question, one approach is to use methods such as dynamic Bayesian networks, which essentially is a probabilistic, graphical modeling approach to understand or try to understand the causal mechanisms underlying a treatment effect. So if we take that data from the original clinical trial and input it into this model, the model tells us by which pathways was neck-specific more effective than physical activity. And there were two main pathways identified by the model. One was a change in the patient's neck endurance, so improvement in physical function. The other was an improvement in the patient's perceived workability index. And those two factors were the main drivers for ultimately a change in pain and the difference between those two exercise interventions. And if we then artificially block within the model an improvement in physical function in the neck, improvement in endurance, or an improvement in the workability index, then actually neck-specific exercise becomes equally effective to physical activity. And so that really, again, highlights that it's not just about pain. We're actually making a difference in terms of function and actually perceived function. So rather than the type of exercise for people with neck pain being simply dictated by a clinician's preference, decisions have to be based on knowledge, skills, and informed by a comprehensive assessment and good old-fashioned clinical reasoning. We need to consider what mechanisms should we be intervening with rather than simply what approach should we choose. So in other words, we need to understand for our patients really what are the key drivers, because ultimately exercise is going to be different depending on the mechanisms. And yes, that may be movement driven for some patients where there's clearly changes in neuromuscular control, poor quality of movement. But for others, of course, there can be a large psychosocial aspect. There could be pathology. It could be biologically driven. And if we understand the various different components by performing a very comprehensive multi-system assessment to tease out the physical factors, to tease out the biological factors, the psychological factors, and so forth, then we're in a better position to understand which components of exercise is going to be relevant for the patient. It may be that a motor control approach is relevant, but it may also be that strengthening is necessary for that patient, or that general changing attitude to exercise and their beliefs of exercise is important. Thinking about the immediate analgesic effects of exercise, for instance, and ultimately developing more individualized strategies and packages of exercises which are more ideally matched to the patient's presentation. Or to illustrate that point, rather than having patients with different presentations and different, for example, pain mechanisms being given the same exercise approach, we need to be more specific, get them into the right exercise that matches the mechanisms driving their painful disorder, and in doing so, hopefully, give them reduced pain, better improvement in function, quality of life, and ultimately, reduced recurrence of neck pain. So I'd like to finish there and just to conclude by saying that yes, perceived pain and disability is clearly very relevant, but pain is multifactorial, and maybe it's time to start looking at other aspects of pain in terms of outcome success. Whilst pain is very important, we should never forget rehabilitation of physical functioning, which really should have an equal focus when we're thinking about prescribing exercise for people with neck pain. There's very clear evidence that neuromuscular adaptations are specific to the mode of exercise, and that is certainly by no means unique to the neck, but that's been shown for the periphery as well as the spine, and therefore we really need to think about targeting mechanisms and functional impairments in addition to pain. Well, very simply, to finish off, my final point is specificity is in fact relevant when prescribing exercise for neck pain. So thank you very much.
Deborah, thank you very much indeed for that fascinating presentation, a clear and compelling case for exercise specificity. And we're going to move straight over now to Simon. Thank you, Simon.
Thank you, and thank you for the invite, and good afternoon, everybody. Hopefully my presentation will appear any second now. Oh, there we go. So to follow on from Dr. Falla, I really want to talk about exercise specificity, but more from an elite sport perspective and how it really drives everything that we do in that world. And I'm going to try and demonstrate that really through exploring spinal exercise prescription, and hopefully some of the reasoning, some of the thoughts that we have will be applicable across a broader spectrum of musculoskeletal practice. So what I want to work through really is firstly the concept of, or the importance of understanding context. And I'll talk a little bit about performance backwards thinking and how that shapes things in sport. I'll talk a little bit about the spinal abilities underpinning performance. And ultimately, as we're physios, of course, we'll talk about the impact of pain and pathology. But perhaps most importantly, we'll move on then to exercise specificity and how it's critical in order to create a very targeted adaptation, whether that's for rehabilitation, whether it's for poor performance itself, or whether it's for mitigating the threat of injury. So what's the difference between performance iteration and performance backwards? Well, performance iteration is that I decide that I want to start jogging, for example. So I jog once a week, then twice a week, and I adapt and I'm doing quite well. So I decide to do three times a week. That's going quite well. So I decide I'm going to run a little bit quicker, and so forth, until I get as far as I can get. And we just keep iterating performance. Performance backwards is a little bit different. Performance backwards always starts with the destination in mind. Ultimately, from an Olympic, Paralympic sport perspective, what do we think it takes to win? And let's give an example here to successfully reach the summit of Mount Everest, for example. If we've got that clear goal, we can then think about what the performance components of that might be. So it might be that we need to be able to successfully climb 20, 30 rock faces of appropriate difficulty on a daily basis. We need to have appropriate provisions. We need to have appropriate navigation, for example. Once those performance components are in place, we can then think, right, well, how are we going to achieve them? What have we got to achieve to order to deliver those components, and how are we going to do it? Once all of that's in place, we can then begin to think about the gap analysis. Where are we now? What's our current state? What's the desired future state? And how do we create an environment in order to create very, very specific adaptations towards achieving that goal? Those adaptations could well be behavioral, they could be structural, they could be physiological, they could be psychological. And we work through them. But of course, the goal doesn't have to be winning an Olympic medal, winning a football match, or whatever. It could, of course, be anything. And we all face patients every day that have very specific goals. It might be a 60-year-old gentleman with low back pain who wants to return to golf, for example. But the process still stands, and it provides the context for how we work. So from a spinal perspective, what does that mean? So we have some goals around performance. We need to try and understand some of the physical qualities that underpin spinal performance. So if you have a look at the video attached, this is a short montage from the Rio Olympics and Paralympic Games. And what I'd look at is what you think might be the spinal abilities underpinning this performance, and look at some of the spinal demands. Hopefully what you'll see is they're incredibly diverse, all the way from huge amounts of movement that requires amazing amounts of precision and timing and adaptability, all the way through to stiffness and force absorption, all the way through to power production and force outcome. So it's very complex, but ultimately skilled movement, whatever type it is underpinned by an interconnected, interdependent, communicating web of physical abilities. So what are some of the challenges we face as clinicians, certainly clinicians in the sporting world? Well, first of all, if we know it's complex and we know performance complex, how do we begin to understand some of these discrete physical qualities, but also how these might link together? Of course, what's the impact of pain and pathology? And how do we define exercise? What language do we use? How do we communicate it amongst ourselves and to the athletes? So about 18 months or so ago, I did a piece of work with Alex Wolf, who was the head of strength and conditioning at the EIS back then, and with Dr. Alison Rushton from the University of Birmingham. And we decided to say, right, well, if we took every single exercise we could possibly think of for a spine, what outcomes would we see? And ultimately, we came up with a classification. And what it was never intended to be was a one-size-all approach to exercise prescription. But it was aimed to create a tool to support clinical reasoning. And of course, it should always be positioned within a clinical and biopsychosocial framework. The critical thing, however, is that exercises within the classification, and I would argue at all times, must be defined by intention and outcome. Exercises can never be defined by the place in which we perform them, by the equipment that we use, by the name that we give them. Pilates exercises, core exercises, don't tell me anything about the intention of that exercise. And so this is the classification. I don't know if I've got a thing there. We essentially had some outcomes at the top there: mobility, motor control, work capacity, and strength. We subclassified the exercises into more non-functional exercises to the left here, or to the right, depending which way you're looking around. These are non-functional exercises, and on the other side we've got more functional exercises. Non-functional exercises performed in non-functional positions, crook lying, kneeling, etc., lying down, and more functional positions like squatting, split standing, etc. We then split the exercises up across the bottom there into dynamic exercises, where there is definitely segmental spinal displacement, or static exercises across the top that are very much related to minimal spinal movement. So I'm going to walk you through that process and how we might think about that from an elite sport context. So when we're looking at mobility and motor control, essentially the foundation of this is how the central nervous system controls the demands between movement and stability, or movement and stiffness. Now, stiffness in sport is critical, particularly under really high loads. It's about effectively placing the spine in an efficient position to absorb force, but it's also about putting it in an effective position to produce force. Conversely, from a movement perspective at the other end of the scale, it's about movement precision and timing and huge amounts of adaptability movement variability. And of course, the central nervous system, when the system is working well, balances these task demands really effectively. But in the presence of pain, it's different. And I think what we see in sport is that the biomechanics of sport play a huge role. So with sporting movements, hopefully the video is playing, we often see these repetitive, habitual movements, often with high forces that occur over significant ranges of motion. And with that, then, you can get this repetitive stress, mechanical loading, of course, tissue sensitization. And a result of that, as we've seen from the previous presentation, we get these aberrant motor patterns that might be quite subtle, and they might be quite overt. And hopefully, with reassurance and with good rehabilitation, we can return these patients and athletes to good function. But of course, there is a population where these maladaptive movement patterns continue, and drives mechanical loading, and begins potentially to change the perception of pain with movement. And of course, you'll all be familiar from a low back pain context that this is fairly acceptable, but we also see it in sport. This is an example of an elite athlete with a 3 to 4 month history of low back pain. And this is just a simple forward bending task. But what you see is that she's really reluctant to segmentally flex in the lumbar spine, much happier hip hinging forwards. She's in discomfort, so we know there's some altered sensory motor processing. She's definitely adopting a rigid motor strategy, definitely has reduced variability. Critically though, these movements are underpinned by thoughts and feelings. There's some fear of movement, there's some associated, will I get back to my sport? What's it going to do to my funding, etc., and it begins to drive these behaviours. So it becomes a critical part to understand. Rehabilitation, alongside reassurance, and explanation about what's gone on with her symptoms is of course about then restoring normal movement, normal segmental movement, trying to manage this increased rigidity. There's some examples there. And of course these segmental movements we could transfer into more functional movements. This is an example of an elite windsurfer actually. It's a photo unfortunately, but he's doing some pelvic tilting exercises, trying to increase the overall movement variability in order to create this whole body coordinated movement return to normal. So this is our patient, a little bit longer, just still a little bit awkward, but certainly a little bit more happy to flex, a little more segmentally, which is great. And now we're flipping it on its head. We're actually using these behaviours, these appropriate behaviours, to drive thoughts and feelings about exercise and promote that to manage some of the fear. The other issue with repetitive movement, and it's a big thing in sport, is that we often get absence of mechanical tension and the resultant loss of tissue length. So of course, if you're a canoe athlete, if this is the movement you're doing over and over and over and over again every single day, there's a risk of this. And of course, therefore, mobility exercises, stretching exercises play a significant part in what we do, if it's appropriate. And that sort of leads nicely onto the concept of regional interdependence. And if you're not familiar with the term, you'll definitely be familiar with the concept. But essentially, it's that the patient's primary musculoskeletal symptoms are directly or indirectly influenced by impairments from various body sources. So if we take this elite level rower, it wouldn't take a huge amount to consider if she had, let's say, hip impingement and loss of hip flexion, that it could dramatically alter her spinal biomechanics and that could become a driver for her pain. It doesn't just have to be hip, it could be any region in the body, and it doesn't have to be loss of movement, it could be loss of strength or any other physical quality that could drive those behaviours. And there's plenty of evidence to support the existence of that concept. But it's not just that they're moving repetitively, it's also how they move that becomes important in the development of low back pain. So this is an athlete. She's got a 3 to 4 week history of back pain, but it's extension related back pain this time. But her pain is driven primarily by squatting, loaded squatting in particular. And so she bends down into flexion, not too bad. Bends into extension, sore into extension. And then a second or two, I ask her to squat. And hopefully what you can see is that in the end range squat position, she's in maximal anterior tilt. If you ask her to anterior tilt, she can't go anymore. She's in absolute end range extension. It's driving this tissue sensitization. And she's doing that, of course, under load in her gym program. So the rehabilitation all of a sudden looks a little bit different. It's then about the appreciation of her ability to dissociate spinal movement and to be aware of her spinal posture. And of course, from a rehabilitation perspective, we can work this in non-functional positions, traveling more towards more sport-specific positions. This is her, for example, exploring spinal posture and its influence with force production, and ultimately back towards the sport. And that's critical. We're always trying to ensure that our exercise prescription has direct correspondence back to the sporting environment. This is her a little bit further on in her rehab. Squat's still a little bit ugly, but she's in a much better posture. She's now not in any pain, and she's happily doing her loaded squats in the gym with no problems. The key thing here is when we're prescribing exercise around motor control, it's generally under low intensities and high frequencies, and that's really, really important, partly because you can't delete a movement pattern or strategy. You can only create a new one and reinforce it that it becomes the dominant one. And so critically, fatigue is also important to avoid. So there's a series of questions we ask ourselves in sport, generally around movement assessment. The first is, when is it symptomatic? Doing what or what movement can't they perform? The second question is, why do we think the way in which they move has the potential to be a contributing factor? Do we think it's a cause? We have to be really careful here. There's some big assumptions we make around this question. People move in all sorts of weird and funky ways, but ultimately, do we think it's a contributing factor? The next question is really, really important. Why is it we think that they're moving that way? It might be because they have to move that way for their performance. It might be that their coach has told them to move that way. It might be that they're in pain and they've got an aberrant motor pattern. It might be that they've got weak hips. It might be that they've got a stiff ankle. It could be absolutely anything. But understanding that is critical in order to ultimately address the movement pattern. Then can we modify it? Will it take can we modify it in the short term? Is it going to take longer? And if we can, what impact does it have, both in terms of pain, but also in terms of their performance? Does it? What we don't want to do is improve their pain and ruin their performance. So there's a balance to be had there. That sort of motor control sort of takes us on nicely then to work capacity. Now, work capacity is critical in physiotherapy and the mainstay of much of the exercise that we prescribe. If you're not familiar with the term, it's essentially the amount of work that you can perform, recover from, and adapt positively to. We know that from a low back pain perspective, for example, that there's a relationship between low back pain and decreased trunk muscular endurance, endurance ratios. We know that the tissue quality is worse, fatty infiltration, muscular atrophy, etc. And we know that loss of muscular endurance, there's a relationship between that and low back pain reoccurrence. So just to describe that, it's essentially how much work can you do relative to how much you're being asked to perform or how much you're performing. If that works out well and you've got a huge amount of ability to do work and you're exposed to some work, your capacity to recover is high, you adapt, you cope, you move on. Conversely, if your ability to do work is slim and you're exposed to high levels of work, your capacity to recover is less, you fatigue, and we see this loss of motor control, biomechanical inefficiency, and potentially injury. So how do we build it? Well, it's about building this big piggy bank of tolerance to work and effort. It's easier to build work capacity with moderately heavy loads, 60-70% 1RM for example. Much harder to do it with heavier loads, strength training loads if you like, 80% and above. And that's just fundamentally, it's harder to recover. And that's particularly pertinent if you've got a deconditioned, if you're working with deconditioned individuals. These are some examples of work capacity exercises for the spine, and you can see a couple of exercises at the top there. They're non-functional exercises performed in non-functional positions. At the bottom, more functional exercises. To the right-hand side, we've got exercises that are formed with a dynamic spine. To the left-hand side, to the other side, sorry, we've got exercises that perform with a static spine. So I'm not. It's not about. Then you have to clinically reason what you're deciding to do. But you can deliver the outcomes in many ways. The key thing is that strength is relative. For one person, exercises like this might be work capacity training. For others, it might be motor control. For others, it might be absolutely maximum strength. So it's critical to view the patients in front of you and judge accordingly. The second is that overload and fatigue is important. If you're going to improve work capacity, you have to make people tired, and you have to make people work in order to drive those structural adaptations. Key thing here is it's not a performance outcome, it's a training outcome. We often use performance tests as a proxy measure, strength endurance tests as a proxy measure for work capacity, but really what I'm interested in is accumulation of training over many weeks, many months, in order to create a very specific tissue, tendon, muscle adaptation. And ultimately that, of course, provides a platform for the development of very specific strength qualities. And then if we look at strength, force development, so the maximum amount of force that you can produce and the speed at which you can produce that force is a critical determinant of performance in sports, no doubt of that. This is an example from a female athlete cohort, and you can see these guys are producing huge amounts of force. This is isokinetic testing data, so really, really important. What's a little bit murky, certainly in the literature, is the relationship between low back pain and strength. However, from our experience, from a sports perspective, it's really, really important. And this is an example here. Athlete 2 has had a history of low back pain. Athlete 1 hasn't. Both of them are in full training. Both of them completely asymptomatic. And athlete 2 and athlete 1 have huge amounts of work capacity, good endurance testing results. But when we look at these, there's clearly a difference between the amount of force that they can produce and the speed at which they can produce it. So of course then the prescription needs to look different again. So when we're looking here, we're looking at producing strength outcomes and stiffness outcomes. How quickly can we produce force? And are we looking at static spinal displacement, or we're looking at augmentation of power and power output? And ultimately then the balance of morphological versus neurological adaptation bias. So essentially that's the classification. In its whole, and perhaps less important is more this triangle. And one of the questions I would ask you to go away is next time you prescribe exercises to your patients, or you consider exercises that you've prescribed recently, where do you think you've created the output? And ultimately, if you think this body of work or this body of exercises creating motor control, fantastic. And there's no problem if you create exercises that potentially touch two different outcomes, as long as you're clear on the outcome that you're trying to chase and the prescription and the nature of the exercises matches that prescription. So some final take-home messages from me. I think human performance is surely an expression of many interdependent physical qualities, and they're always influenced by thoughts, feelings, and beliefs. And unlocking those is critical if we're going to create appropriate behaviour change. Exercise is always defined by intention and outcome, and that's a critical element, important in terms of communication. And reductionism is rarely successful, and that's because injury causation and humans just incredibly complex. Thank you very much.
Simon, thank you very much indeed for that. So a huge amount of information. Claire, we've just got a few moments for questions. Have you got them through the hashtag or no? Okay, so in which case, we could just take both Deborah and Simon have very kindly said they'll be around if anyone wants to come and have a discussion in the break. We're going to have a half hour break in a few moments before the final plenary session back in here. So you will have an opportunity to have a one-to-one conversation after that. But has anyone got any questions from the floor in the few minutes we've got before the awards? Okay, I can see, I don't know if we've got microphones, but I can see, yep, there's the microphone. Middle of the back section, I think the microphone's on its way to you. Helpfully standing up, thank you very much indeed. Hi, thank
Hello,
you.
Hello, hi, my name is Lampros. Dr. Falla, what do you think is the direction of the relationship between neuromuscular dysfunction and pain? Do you think there is a relationship, and what's the direction? Thank you.
Yeah, so there have been a few studies that have specifically examined that relationship, so the extent of change in neuromuscular function and the extent of pain intensity, showing that there is in fact a direct relationship. So the higher severity of symptoms, the greater signs of neuromuscular dysfunction. It's not always a clear-cut relationship. There are a number of other factors, but certainly there's evidence to support that relationship.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Deborah. Another question? Anyone else? I can't see hands too easily from here. I've got one if no one else has. So, Simon, you very kindly finished with a few take-home messages, which was very helpful for me. And I was just wondering whether I could ask both of you, I don't know how many people sitting in front of here today listening are sort of frontline clinicians trying to see a whole lot of different people with a whole lot of different problems, but I suppose I'm thinking, what would be the one thing that you would say arising out of the huge body of work you've done and your work with elite sport? So maybe Simon first. One thing people could take away, do you think?
I was hoping Deborah was going to go first, and I was going to copy.
Oh my goodness. I mean, it's a really difficult question. No, I think actually both Simon and I have both said a very similar story in the fact that despite the fact that commonly a one-size-fits-all approach has been adopted, which of course is an easy approach, it's just simply, it's insufficient, and we need to think about offering more individualized and personalized treatments, whether that be in an athletic population or not. So I would say that. And hand it back over to Simon.
Thank you, Deborah. Simon, you can't get away with
no,
that.
No, I think for me, the whole thing here is around injury causality, and it's incredibly complex. And I think as a clinician, you can be faced with what feels like a million different options, but ultimately it's trying to work out with what we think is more likely than others to be driving symptoms. And as a result of that, once we're clear, actually, we'll focus on these things to start with, then making sure our exercise prescription is delivering that outcome. And then from that point on, we can review. But exercise specificity is critical.
Thank you. And that came across so clearly in both your different presentations, so thank you for that. Any final questions from anyone who hasn't yet had the... Please do stick your hand up, any question, however complex, however simple. We've probably got about 1 minute, so if there is anything... Here, you've got the microphone. The guy holding the microphone's got the question, so that makes life very easy. Go ahead.
You're very, very loud. You'll have to forgive me. So, as a student, I just had a quick question, really, with regards to any advice. I think you've got that. From what I've seen, not saying this very well, but do you think there's a fear in some practitioners to push individuals enough with strength training? And you talked about that overload and that importance of fatigue to get adaptations. Do you think there's potentially a fear in some practitioners to push some patients? And I'm particularly thinking of older patients, so I know it's slightly different. But and any advice you might have to help clinicians with that?
Thank you very much for the question. This time I'm going to make Simon go first.
Well, I think I'll go back to my point about strength is relative. So it doesn't matter what patient you have in front of you, you can always develop their physical qualities. The starting point is just slightly different. But ultimately, don't be fearful of it. Just be very mindful of where someone's starting point is. I think in elite sport, we're really, really comfortable with it because we're working with that sort of population. But ultimately, whoever you have in front of you, just make sure you tailor your starting point of exercise and then progressively move it forward. You can always regress or progress. But ultimately have a view in front of you and have a go for it. One of the key things is asking them afterwards, like, was that tiring? And if the answer that comes back is no, you're probably not going to create that sort of work capacity adaptation.
Thank you, Simon. Deborah?
No, I was actually going to comment on the fact also that if you're prescribing exercise progressively, then the type of exercise, the load, the frequency, the duration and so forth, then I think by the time they get to those higher load strength training exercises, then you shouldn't be so fearful because they've been through that, the progress to get to that point. But it's essentially what Simon said.
Great, thank you both very much.
But I'll just add, sorry, don't be fearful of strength training. Like, strength becomes a scary word, it isn't. And it's a space that is absolutely critical for us to step into. So don't feel that physiotherapists work in motor control only. And strength and conditioning coaches only work in that sort of space. Mm. It's a space we should really embrace and encourage and own, I think.
And I think it's a great question, as you said, thinking about people who are older, because obviously we all know that's a growing number of the people that everyone's seeing and critical in that group as well as in elite sport or younger group. Thank you very much indeed for the questions. As promised, we're going to move. I'm going to hand back over to Claire now.